My name is Charisse, and today I would be explaining all about Jupiter from the Planets by Gustav Holst. And today I would be explaining about my analysis and the background of this song and the background of the composer, where is he from, and all this kind of stuff. So bear with me, and we're gonna start with our first question. What is Jupiter? And where does the idea of that planet name came from? Okay, so the Planets, Opus 32, is a seven-movement orchestral suite by the English composer Gustav Holst. Written between 1914 and 1916, each movement of the suite is named after a planet of the solar system and its corresponding astrological character as defined by Holst. The concept of the work is astrological rather than astronomical, which is why the Earth is not included, although Sun and Moon are also not included while including the non-traditional Uranus and Neptune. Each movement is intended to convey ideas and emotions associated with the influence of the planets on the psyche, not the Roman deities. The idea of the work was suggested to Holst by Clifford Bax, who introduced him to astrology when the two were part of a small group of English artists holidaying in Majorca in the spring of 1913. Holst became quite a devotee to the subject and would cast his friend's horoscopes for fun. And so now we're going to figure out who is Gustav Holst. So Gustav Theodor Holst was an English 20th century composer, arranger, and teacher, best known for his orchestral suite, The Planets. He composed many other works across a range of genres, although none achieved comparable success. Holst excluded the Earth in his composition because it has no astrological significance, and Pluto was not discovered until the 1930s. He died in 1934. But there is little evidence that he considered updating his piece. He plays the trombone, which is why I think it can be correlated that his orchestral compositions from the Planets has an amazing brass instrumentation scoring. So today, we are going to dig deeper onto the fourth movement, Jupiter, the Bringer of Jollity, and we are going to analyze this incredible song. So, Jupiter name comes from the fifth planet of the Sun and the largest in the solar system. It is a gas giant with a mass 1,000 that of the Sun. Jupiter is one of the brightest objects visible to the naked eye in the night sky and has been known to ancient civilizations since before recorded history. It is named after the Roman god Jupiter, the god of the sky and thunder and king of the gods in ancient Roman religion and mythology. Jupiter was the chief deity of Roman state religion throughout the Republican and Imperial eras, until Christianity became the dominant religion of the empire. So next, we're gonna analyze the instrumentation and structure of this Jupiter song. So the work is scored for a large orchestra consisting of the following instrumentation: two piccolos, two flutes, three oboes, an English horn, three clarinets in B-flat, bass clarinet in B-flat, three bassoons, double bassoon, six horns in F, four trumpets in C, three tenor trombones, one bass trombone, tenor tuba in B-flat, bass tuba, six timpani with two players, triangle tambourine, cymbals, bass drum, glockenspiel, two harps, first violins, second violins, violas, violoncellos, and double basses. This song is in the key of G major and holds a catchy melody line at its 19th page. It modulates to E flat major and introduces a new theme and a new feeling of atmosphere than its previous spacey setting. We're going to listen a short phrase of Jupiter right now.
Thank you.
So after hearing a short piece of that song, why does it seem like we have heard that melody line before? Is it a bit catchy? The ta da dum da 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 da. That is very catchy to me when I first heard it. And it turns out that it is because the famous I Vow to Thee My Country, a British patriotic hymn, was set to music by Gustav Holst. In 1921, Gustav Holst adapted the music from a section of Jupiter from his suit, The Planets, to create a setting for the poem by the diplomat Sir Cecil Spring-Rice, written in 1908 or 1912, entitled Urbs Dei, which means the City of God or the Two Fatherlands. The poem describes how a Christian owes his loyalties to both his homeland and the heavenly kingdom. The music was extended slightly to fit the final two lines of the first verse. At the request of the publisher Kirwan, Holst made a version as a unison song with the orchestra. In 1926, Holst harmonized the tune to make it usable as a hymn, which was included in the hymnal Song of Praise. In that version, the lyrics were unchanged, but the tune was then called Thaxt, named after the village where Holst lived for many years. The editor of the new 1926 edition of Song of Praise was Holst's close friend Ralph Vaughan Williams, which may have provided the stimulus for Holst's cooperation in producing the hymn. Holst's daughter, Imogen, recorded that, at the time when he was asked to set these words to music, Holst was so overworked and overweary that he felt relief to discover they fitted the tune from Jupiter. So next, we're going to do the form analysis, and this is a personal analysis of mine, so it's just a brief and a short one, but I hope you understand, and it gives you some imagination of what like the full score would sound like. Okay, so just like Mars and Mercury, Holst used patterns to create Jupiter. The first pattern is a two sets of three note ostinatos in violins which start at measure one. You can see that the first set uses EGA and the second uses ACD. Both sets of three note ostinatos have the note A in common. Both sets also have in common the same intervals of minor third and major second. The combination of notes in these two ostinatos results in the pentatonic scale, which is the C, D, E, G, A. Next, the second pattern is the first theme in Jupiter. This theme makes its first appearance from measure 6 to 12 in horns, violas, and cellos. The third pattern is a motif which consists of two sets of three note and one set of four note ascending arpeggiated figures. The motif first appears in horns in measures 29 until 31. The fourth pattern is the second theme of Jupiter. This theme appears for the first time from measure 65 until measure 76 in horns, violins, violas, and cellos. The fifth pattern is the counter melody of the second theme. It appears in the form of a melodic bass line in bass tuba and double basses from measures 65 to 76. The sixth pattern in the Jupiter is the third theme. It appears for the first time from measures 108 to measures 115 in horns. The seventh pattern is a four-note basso ostinato. It first appears in strings from measures 108 until measures 111. The eighth pattern is the fourth theme of Jupiter. This is the longest melodic line Holst writes in the Planets, totaling in 17 measures in length. The fourth theme first appears in strings and horns from measures 193 to the second beat of measure 209. These are the measures that hold up the song I Vow to Thee My Country. The melodic line of da da dum da 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 dum 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 and so on. And so we're gonna move on to some of the melodic analysis I made through viewing the full score. Holst uses ascending scales in several places within Jupiter. The first ascending scale is in woodwinds from measure 75 to 77. Holst appeared to be using two adjunct diatonic scales with several notes in common. The Mixolydian scale in D is used from the second half of measure 75 to the first half of measure 76. The B Locrian scale is used for the second half of measure 76. This takes place similarly in the woodwinds from measures 315 to 316. Holtz used the Dorian scale. Next, Holtz used a chromatic scale near the end of Jupiter in woodwinds and strings from measure 393 to 394. You can see the notes ascending chromatically. And so now I'm gonna do an extra review of what else does this planet composition by Holtz inspire. So we know that the planet is a composition about astrology. Holtz was inspired by astronomy and all those kind of stuff. That's why he composed this piece. And so his inspiration also inspires some other composers in the 21st century, such as Star Wars music. John Williams' classical influences derived from Holtz, other than the composer shot into orbit by Stanley Kubrick in 2001, and the composers literally shot into orbit on Voyager 2 with Bach, Mozart, and Beethoven, there's no composer in the classical repertoire who's more closely associated with outer space than Gustav Holtz. The planet has been mined for any number of sci-fi spectaculars, and Mars in particular has been a favorite of film composers including Williams, whose stormtroopers march to a distinctly Martian beat. In the movies, in the original trilogy, this theme follows the villainous Darth Vader in the prequels. It presages the dark fate of Anakin Skywalker. This music is always a cue to the audience that an evil is afoot. In classical music, the march underlying rhythm recalls another celestial score, Gustav Holtz's The Planets. The subjects of Holtz's suit, however, are more mythological than astronomical. Mars, which resembles Darth Vader's march, is subtitled The Bringer of War. And now we're going to compare of the Star Wars Darth Vader theme and Gustav Holtz's march for an extra. I hope you enjoy! So now, that concludes all of my explanation and analysis of Jupiter from the Planets by Gustav Holtz. I hope you understand and you enjoy this video. Thank you for watching. God bless you.